mountains in the form of streams and rivers. That is the Prakriti. So flowing water, stagnant water, subtle water, uncondensed water particles that are condensed in the form of rain, everything is Prakriti. And Vikriti is the same water present in the form of salival juice, intestinal juice, tears in the form of juice in fruits, everything is in the form of Vikriti. So water that substantially converts the primary nutritional matter, the primary energy which is in the form of solid, is diluted, potentialized, made compatible only by water. This is driven by an aerial force which is there in the form of oxygen to us, which is in the form of carbon dioxide to plants, which is in the form of nitrogen for fixation, which is in the form of methane for the abysmal species inside the oceans. So we are governed by three forces, in which the mediator is the water. We are governed by solid nutrition, which is diluted, driven and made compatible by a liquid force, which is pressurized by means of a pull or push of an aerial compression, by which this nutritional balance is traveling throughout the body, making a person to survive. Our survival between the aerial pressure and this contemporary system of contributive nutrition which we are studying in the form of solid foods, everything is put into balance only by water. So water is not only food, but it is also energy, it is also medicine. Water is having three things. One is ambrosia, second is panacea, third thing is a food. So it is nutritia, panacea and ambrosia. When it feeds you, it is nutritia. When it gives you knowledge, when it gives you comfort and elates you, and also elates your standard, enlightens you, that becomes ambrosia. And whenever that solves you all the diseases, all the predicaments of your bio imbalances, that becomes panacea. So understanding of nutrition of water has been made by people, but understanding of water as panacea and ambrosia has been made only by the scriptural study or the natural observation method. So substratum is earth, promoter is the water, the inducer is the air, and magma is what we call Bhugarbha. It is inside the earth, it cooks everything, it processes everything. We have Jatragni inside, each and everything is a thermal output. Kopagni, Krodhagni, Manthagni, Kamagni, Tapagni, Ichagni, each and every impulse of our desire, depression, frustration, invocation, provocation, subjection, inquisitiveness, each and every tenth and trend of our mind and intellect is a small, that is known as subtle hydral pressure, which is executed by a thermal induction. So in the science of psychochemistry, they consider everything to be thermal units. Everything is considered to be Agni. So Agni is a processor for everything. If air is an inducer, Agni is a processor, and the reservoir for replenishment and restoration is the ether. This is known as the Panchabhuta, the five primordial, or the penta primordial elemental study of nature of our ancestral tradition. So starting with that, coming to the contemporary studies, water has also its own zodiac. I have framed a hydral zodiac in one lecture on water. Water has 12 divisions we have to understand. Number 1, drought. Number 2, it is flood. Number 3, irrigation. Number 4, it is drainage. Number 5, it is rain. Number 6, recycling. Number 7, water treatment. Number 8, as oceanography. Number 9, the issue of river linking, which is there now. And exobiosis, water possibility in other planets. That is the 10th issue. 11th issue is hydroelectricity power project with water. Number 12th is special utility of water in ceremonial, ritualistic and philosophical applications. This is a hydral zodiac which we have made. I think that it requires 3 days of seminar, 12 speakers speaking exclusively about these divisions. But still I will try to put it with the maximum possibility within the limited time frame. Number 1, first I have already told flood. There are 3 problems with water. Water crisis is somebody considering non-availability of water. Non-availability of water, number 1. Second thing, over-availability of water which cannot be tapped, irrigated or potted. Third thing, availability of water which is not drinkable because of pollution and some other contaminations. So, not availability of water, sufficient water. Availability of over-efficient water which cannot be tappable. Third thing is availability of water which is not drinkable because of its inherent contamination, which may be a peril to human life inhabitation or at least pernicious to his salubrity. So these 3 things we are going to take in this mega issue. Flood is very much we are famous. Everywhere we are reading about Bihar flood. Every year there is no newspaper or there is no such incident which is devoid of a flood report from Bihar. So how to manage this flood? Unfortunately, I want to say that Indian Engineering Department or the Engineering Infrastructure Management has not been improved or has not technically improved or not funded also to deal with this type of thing. That is a special type of engineering to control flood. It is known as active river dynamic engineering. The name itself is very much Hellenistic and Hellenistic and Greek related to most of the engineers. It is active river dynamic engineering, which is very specially to be designed for flood. What is the location? What is the total area connected? And what is the river basin depth? What is the capability of water retention and storage? What is the flow velocity? What is the water that can be retained? What is the danger limit? And what is the limit of observation that we are having possibilities for discharge? It is known as active river dynamic engineering survey. Apart from which, there are few methods in understanding these things. One is erosion problem. Second is inundation problem. The third thing is landslide problem is there. Third thing is bridge embankment problem. Fourth thing is sedimentation problem. Fifth thing is river shifting problem. Sixth thing is waterways for road and railways. That is also an issue now in growing infrastructure. How to deal with all of these things, we have to say. Number one, in the problem of erosion, we have to measure the area eroded and the water flow velocity, etc. In inundation, we have to measure the water flow, the density of water, overflow, and the drainage possibilities for the water, and impact on infrastructure damage, impact on live losses, as well as loss of livestock, etc. How we can govern all of these things. And each and everything has its own steps of understanding. Now they have been making lot of things like there is a possibility of constructing spurs. For erosion, we can make spurs, we can make guidance bunks, we can make revetors or revital devices, and we can make embankment devices, we can make tolerant devices, we can make gradual suppressors, we can make underlying storages and deviators we can make. And also for flood management, there are three possibilities. One is afforestation ground possibility. Second thing is deviation of the same thing to the local wetlands. And third thing is gradual depreciation or gradual reconsideration of the water velocity by iron bunks, which are known as interim bunks, which are there in the gradual flow shift or flow velocity of the floods. And actually, Mississippi, due to Katrina, you know that it has been heavily flooded. And Bihar, due to the Kasi River, how much it is flooded, it is known. But the active river dynamic engineering that is specially there, which requires a lot of things. One is evacuation of people and properties. Second thing is to create a zonal differentiations by which it is a danger zone, and it is a risk zone, it is a crisis zone and safer zone. You have to make zonal platform and analysis, and we must know about the aboriginal of the inhabitation and aboriginal of the flood. Flood affecting a particular people or inhabitation area is different from the aboriginal area. So starting from the aboriginal area itself, there are three possibilities. That is why very great experts, they used to say, India is well versed in flood control, not in flood management. So starting from the aboriginal area, three possibilities. First possibility is, can it be tapped and converted into energy resources? Number two, can it be diverted to some other area where the loss can be prevented or minimized? Number three, even if it enters, how to train the people in self-management and mitigation of probable losses and risks at the time of flood? How to make flood management as a course which should be given for the NGOs, self-training and group training exercises? These things are very much essential. And comparing to that of the developed nations, we are very much behind. For example, China, it is having 2,77,000 of river dikes with 8,500 reservoirs and 7 super specialized river flood management special devices up there. So flood engineering systems have been installed in 7 major power blocks of river dynamics with 8,500 reservoirs and 2,77,000 of river dikes. This is not there with us. We have already designed few things which I want to say. The Central Board for Irrigation and Power, along with the National Hydro Power Project, both of the people, they have proposed before a decade a good proposal for Brahmaputra and tapping of Brahmaputra resources for getting 40,000 megawatt of electricity possible. So that reduces the pain and strain of flood management, as well as the risk of loss of lives, shifting, evacuation and inconveniences, as well as producing good, well-tanned, refined, clean, zero wastage, powerful resources to the country for increasing the power wealth of our nation. But that has been put into total dustbin and it has not been considered at all. Only particular project has been sanctioned before 8 years, which is also there in still hold, which requires more augmentation and more participation. It is not there. And even in the system of, there are innumerable systems, no doubt we have developed. After that independence, in the 60 years, we have made 4,000 dams. And we are capable of making billions of units more than 220 billion